Now, it wouldn't be NI week without two things. The first, of course, is 100-degree weather. And the second is major news about our LabVIEW platform. So here to talk to me about the latter, I'd like to welcome up to the stage Vice President of Application Software R&D, David Fuller, and Product Managers Simon Hogg and Andy Chang. Welcome, guys. Welcome, David.
Thanks, Eric. As Eric described, our vision of system design is really about enabling you, the world's systems designers, to create some pretty amazing applications. I find it inspirational the impact that you're having with LabVIEW, because LabVIEW truly is at the heart of graphical system design. It provides the software abstractions that power your access to the waves of silicon that are riding Moore's Law, specifically the processors and the FPGAs and the IOs that are in your hardware systems. Now, I know when Jeff Kay first envisioned LabVIEW, he didn't have in mind all the creative and interesting ways that you would use it, never mind the truly strange. I mean, body odor detection? Okay. So LabVIEW has truly democratized system design. Children programming robotic toys are systems designers. So too are scientists and engineers programming big boy toys, like the CERN Large Hadron Collider and the SpaceX Dragon rocket ship. Now, it should come as no surprise to you NI Week veterans that we're here to announce the next version of the LabVIEW platform, LabVIEW 2012.
I heard a turkey call in the back there.
Now, in LabVIEW 2012, we've focused very intensely on your productivity and your proficiency. Now, we know that LabVIEW is a very approachable programming language, but we also know that you can write bad code in any programming language.
Whoa. Man, you know, Dave, I started my career as an application engineer, so I got, you know, my share of spaghetti code, but I don't think I ever saw one to compare to that.
Yeah, this is a particularly bad example that we actually found live in the wild. We know the developer who wrote it, but we're not going to name any names. Now, in order to help you build better code and build this and not that, we focused intensely on harvesting the knowledge of hundreds of years of development experience we have within NI R&D, our systems engineers, and some of our lead alliance members. We've taken that and captured best practices and architectural patterns that the beginning user can use to avoid that blank VI syndrome and innovate with confidence from a strong architectural foundation. For our more advanced users, we believe you can start from these user starting points with these templates and sample projects to really add your code quickly and innovate into the special application areas you need to take it. Now, to dive a little bit deeper, I'd like to have Simon give us an example of some of the code.
Sure, David. The first thing you'll notice in LabVIEW 2012 is our new simplified getting started window. From here, I can click Create Projects, and this will bring up a list of all the starting points that we have. Templates are skeleton code for common frameworks and design patterns that we see people implementing over and over. And we also have sample projects, which are fully working applications that you can use as a basis for your own customized uses. So I'll select one, hit Next, we can give it a name, some other options, such as a prefix, so I don't get it confused with all the other ones and my typos. And then we'll hit finish. And what LabVIEW is going to do now is create a new project for me using my settings, renaming files. So the code that I get is as if I wrote it myself. And then I can open it up, and right out of the box, I'm just going to run it. This isn't one of those canned demos that we show you. This is the way the product runs. I'll select my hardware device, and I can acquire some data right out of the box.
Yeah, I just want to reiterate that, yeah, give applause for that. Yeah, I want to reiterate, it didn't just create shell code. I mean, you basically have a running application right out of the box.
Sure, and we've implemented quite a few useful features. You can see along the side of the screen here all the different operations that are in place, but we know you're going to want to do more than this. So we've written these with scalability in mind. Take a quick look at the code. You can see that we followed our own recommended best practices Dave alluded to with regards to program architecture and programming style. We've also added liberal amounts of documentation to let you know where to make changes and where to customize the functionality to meet your own needs. Now, it so happens this is the simplest of the sample projects, and it's based on the simple state machine template. We have many more for addressing larger systems that involve multiple loops and multiple targets, and we think you'll find these a very productive time saver.
Thanks, Simon. So, in addition to the templates and sample projects, we also wanted to invest a lot in proficiency and learning resources. So we have a LabVIEW skills guide, which should help you, regardless of where you are on the proficiency curve, know what resources are available to you. Very importantly, we've made available online self-paced training. This is available to anyone who's purchased LabVIEW 2012 or is active on service. It's essentially the LabVIEW Basics through Advanced course with over 25 hours of learning content. We encourage you to use it.
Now, Dave, I know last year at NI Week, we put a real emphasis on our focus of stability in LabVIEW 2011, and that was very well received by all of our users. Let's give an update on where we stand on that effort today.
Sure thing. So we really view it as our job in R&D. We have to balance both radical innovation and still delivering an extremely high-quality platform. You'll see on the chart behind me the inflow rate of cars, which is our euphemism for bugs. And you can see that 2012 has the lowest inflow rate of bugs of any release to date. Now, you cynics in the audience who might want to game metrics like this could say, well, you just reduced testing. But it's also the most tested version of LabVIEW that we've ever released. Not only have we fixed more bugs, we fixed more of the right bugs. Last year, we introduced a feature called NI Error Reporting. It's essentially a way that if you unfortunately run into a bug with LabVIEW, you can report it quickly back to NI R&D, and we'll bin the common occurrences of bugs and get a nice histogram, which tells us right away which bug we can fix first. We're pretty smart and can figure out that the big, tall one is the one we should go after. Now, if you do run into this dialogue, one, I'm sorry, and two, please report the bug so that we can make LabVIEW better for you. So in addition to error reporting, we're introducing a feature in 2012 called the Customer Experience Improvement Program. Now, if you opt into this feature, it'll allow us to monitor and observe how you're using LabVIEW, what primitives you use, how you use the palette. This is really about us collecting usability metrics so that we can tune the product better for you. I want to emphasize that it's opt-in only. If you don't choose to participate, we won't collect any data and return anything back to NI. But from the R&D side, this is really, really valuable insight into how you're using LabVIEW, and it'll only make the product better, so I encourage you to please participate. So in addition to trying to find out more about how you're using LabVIEW, we're always engaged with our community in the online forums, especially things like the Idea Exchange. I know the developers on the R&D team really love the interaction between the community members with their clever avatars and the features that you've requested. We've already advanced slides, but basically the stuff you saw on the Idea Exchange are features that we've implemented at users' request in LabVIEW 2012. Now, I know that NI Week is also a veritable LabVIEW Woodstock, and that many of you guys have already been with us for a really long time and taken advantage of our certified training programs. And I'd like to take a moment to have everyone in the audience who is certified developer or an architect or certified with LabVIEW in any way to please stand.
Come on, don't be shy, stand up. Let's give these system designers a round of applause. Look at that.
That's great. Now, we hear from our customers throughout the world very regularly that we simply don't have enough skilled LabVIEW programmers throughout the world. I really want to encourage everybody in the audience who's not yet certified to take a look at the 2012 resources we have available for proficiency. The world truly needs more skilled LabVIEW programmers.